5-pointer. Here's the scramble. What British king held the throne when Louis XVI was guillotined in France, Pauline?
George III.
George III is right. It was 1792. Obey these questions. Who reigned in Britain when the American Congress signed the Declaration of Independence?
George III.
Once again. And who was the British ruler when Leon Trotsky was assassinated in Mexico?
George VI.
George VI is right. It was 1940. Oh, a question here on pretentious proverbs. It's open. We have rewritten some familiar English proverbs. 10 points for each one you translate back into ordinary English, into familiar form. The mental condition engendered by adversity is enamored of a multiplicity of individuals in the immediate environment. Pauline.
Too many cooks spoil the broth?
No. Eric Hammer, do you want to try? The proverb is misery loves company. How about this one now? Nebulous, meteorological phenomena are with certitude, Simon?
Every cloud has a silver lining.
That's right, that's right. Diurnal consumption of pomaceous material averts the arrival of Ross.
An apple a day keeps a doctor away.
Yes, sir. And I have one left. A plenitude of multiformities and, Eric.
Too many cooks spoil the broth.
No, here it is for Oak Bay. A plenitude of multiformities and heterogeneities contributes pungency to animate existence. Pauline.
Variety is the spice of life.
Yes, ma'am. Score, Oak Bay has 125. Eric Hammer, 65. And the question here is a 35-pointer with a scramble. What was the name of the artists and writers' quarter of 19th century Paris? Michael.
The Latin Quarter?
No. Alan?
Montmartre.
Montmartre is right. Oak Bay, try these places. A section of London, famous for foreign restaurants, delicatessens, street markets, traffic jams, and crime.
Soho?
It is. The nickname for the vice and gambling quarter on the waterfront of San Francisco, especially notorious in the 1850s?
Fisherman's Wharf?
No, it was the Barbary Coast. Fisherman's Wharf is respectable. And this one, the main shopping center of Chicago, surrounded by elevated railroad tracks. It is the Loop. Pop music. Okay, the question's on top hits on the music charts of the past few months. For 10 points each, identify these vocalists. Simon.
Patsy Gallant?
No. I'll take an answer from Roger.
Gaynor, Gloria Gaynor?
Thelma Houston, right? Here's the next. Simon.
Jimmy Buffett.
No. Pauline.
Marshall Tucker?
That's the answer. The Marshall Tucker Band. Try this one now. Two vocalists. Sorry, Charlie, for the imposition. No help, please, from the audience. Okay. Answer is Daryl Hall and John Oates, and I have one left. You'll have no trouble with this. Pauline.
Barry Manilow.
Yeah, you got it in time. With a score, Oak Bay 160, Eric Hammer 65. It's time now for our special question. And tonight, the students are going to do some brainstorming on kind of an interesting topic. There's a possible 50 points for each team here. And the topic is, how can we solve the energy crisis? You've read a lot about it, you've heard a lot about it, and I thought it's about time we heard your side because you are going to have to live with it. Who's going to be first on this? Roger Cluley of Oak Bay.
The ultimate energy source is nuclear fusion, which fuel of it is seawater. And we wouldn't have much problems with running out of seawater, I don't think. The technology of this is not perfected, but it's the same power that the sun uses. In the meantime, hydrogen gas may be used because it uses the same source transportation systems as we presently use. Also, the byproduct is water and no pollution.
All right, Roger, I'm going to cut you right there because there are seven others to be heard from, one of whom might well be Michael Potter of Eric Hammer.
The problem lies mainly in conserving present resources until alternatives can be found. Automobiles consume far too much of today's non-renewable petroleum products. Mass transportation should be brought into the scene more and more. It can become efficient and workable for a major part of the populace.
My goodness, you've been doing some heavy thinking on this.
Insulated inexpensively, thereby saving a great deal.
And you still are. Thank you, Michael. Eric Promislow, same team.
I think the problem lies a lot more closer to what we can do. Basically, ag transportation, it's a waste. Look at all the people who drive to and from work every day by themselves. Five times a week, it all adds up. And recreation, those 2 mile per gallon motor vehicles have to go. Why not hike? It's much more enjoyable and you'll get more benefits out of it. for going to work, we can all try bicycling. It's worked fine in Holland and other European countries. There's no reason why it can't work here.
All right, Eric, thank you. Now I'd like to hear from Pauline Bunn.
Solving the energy crisis, I think, will come down to personal effort and personal sacrifice. We'll have to change our lifestyle. We'll have to give up certain energy-consuming amenities for something maybe less efficient or a little less than we're used to. So if we can change this attitude, maybe the first step to the energy crisis can be solved.
Alan Horgan, you had a comment.
Yes. I believe that there are several ways in which we could help solve the energy crisis. I think the first, most important thing would be fuel rationing. And one of the best ways to get at the root of this problem is with international arms limitation, I feel. There is a tremendous amount of energy expended on defense, and I feel that we could have our expectancy of our sources of energy for several more years if we cut down.
Thank you, Alan. That's an interesting perspective. I'm going to go diagonally back up to the top to Eric Hambers, Ross Chisholm.
Industrialized civilization uses vast amounts of energy per person. Since we cannot reasonably or safely lower individual energy requirements, we must therefore lower the number of individuals. The world will have 6 billion people by the year 2000. If we expect to live in reasonable comfort, we must in some way convince the world to lower its population growth, or we will all be eventually pulled down.
Now, there is a very pragmatic point of view. Terry Barnett now for Oak Bay.
Governmental attitudes to the big oil companies must change. The power of the oil companies in influencing policy and decisions of democratically elected governments must be curtailed. The Seven Sisters, better known as the big oil companies, have been a separate power until now by themselves, and I think this must end.
Simon Van Norden, I guess you get the bat to clean up on this issue.
Well, one of the ways to solve the energy crisis is to find new sources of energy. A good source is solar energy. It provides over 90% of all the available energy that's found at the Earth's surface. And it's a source that isn't going to run out for a long time. Another good source would be, as Roger mentioned, hydrogen fusion. It's similar to the current atomic fission process using atomic power plants, only it's cleaner, safer, and, like you said, it uses seawater as a fuel, and we've got plenty of that. And if we could harness either of these sources, our energy demands would be solved for centuries.
Thank you, students. Your opinions, as usual, were intriguing and covered a wide variety of perspectives on a very urgent problem. Now, a problem is going to be for our judges to score this exchange of ideas, and we're going to turn it over to them here with a halftime score, Oak Bay 160, Eric Hamber 65. We'll be back with more following these messages. The halftime score in tonight's championship final has Oak Bay with 200, Eric Hamber with 105. Those scores are larger than when we left you, and the reason is 40 points for each team scored for brainstorming on the subject, how can we solve the energy crisis? Short snappers now for 10 points each. What element has the chemical symbol BE? Michael.
Beryllium.
You're right. Who composed The Sorcerer's Apprentice? Alan.
Dukas.
What is the official name of mainland China? Terry Barnett.
People's Republic of China.
Okay, with which scientist do you associate the word Eureka? It was Ross?
Aristotle.
No. Roger?
Archimedes.
Archimedes is correct. Here's an open question for 30. 211 years ago, on the night of June 20th, 1756, a band of 146 Europeans were crowded into a small... Ross?
The Plains of Abraham.
No, a small guardroom by the attacking forces of the Nawab of Bengal. The next morning only, Pauline?
Clive? India?
No, the answer is the Black Hole of Calcutta, and unfortunately, you didn't wait for the question. The city remained under the Nawab until the following January, when a British force regained Calcutta under the command of what colonel? It was Pauline?
Clive, India.
Clive is right. The following June, about a year after the fall of Calcutta, the British won their greatest victory of the campaign and began the territorial expansion, which eventually gave them control of the whole subcontinent. Name the battle. Ross?
Hyderabad.
No. Oak Bay? It was Plassey. 25-pointer. Here's the scramble. Who took the Fay Wray part in the new version of Alan?
Jessica Lange.
That's right, the new version of King Kong. Oak Bay. What recent comedy starring Gene Wilder and Richard Pryor takes the action on a train ride?
Silver Streak.
Silver Streak is right. In 1977, what colorful and comical feline struck again to a musical theme by Henry Mancini?
Pete Mather.
Okay, tough question. Famous epitaphs now. The question is open. I'll give you the inscription, and you give me the person to whom it refers.
Reader, if you seek a memorial, Ross?
Christopher Wren.
Christopher Wren is right. Look about you. Here, a mound suffices for whom the world was not large enough. Pauline?
Churchill?
No. Ross?
Alexander the Great.
That's right. Aren't you glad you guessed? Try this one now. An Irish poet cast a cold eye on life, Eric?
Yeats.
Yeats is right. On death, horsemen passed by. Eric Hamburg got all those. The game is closer. Here's a 35-pointer with a scramble. In mathematics, what general name is given to a curve formed by the intersection of a plane with a right circular cone? Simon.
Ellipse?
No. Terry.
Hyperbola.
Conic section. Would you like some French? You're going to get some French. You're using the telephone, but the responses are in French. Let's hear your translations.
Vous avez atteint un numéro non publié.
Michael.
You have a number that's been disconnected.
I'll give you five for that. I'd like to hear it again for Oak Bay.
Vous avez atteint un numéro non publié.
Terry.
You have attained an unpublished number, unlisted.
Yes, an unlisted number. That gives Oak Bay the other five. Now, this one, and better let it go all the way through.
Au son du timbre, veuillez laisser votre message.
Go. Terry.
At the sound of the tone, leave your message.
That's right. Here's another.
Ce numéro n'est pas en opération.
Eric.
Your number isn't in working order.
That's right, or not in service. Right. And one more.
Ce message est enregistré.
Simon.
Your message has been taken?
No. Once again for Oak Bay.
Ce message est enregistré.
Terry.
The message is incomprehensible.
No, this is a recorded message. Here's a 35-pointer. Here's a scramble. What composer is honored annually in a summer festival in his birthplace of Salzburg? Ross.
Mozart.
Mozart is right. Eric Hamber. Which of Beethoven's symphonies is called the Pastoral? Try it.
The fifth?
No, it's number six. Canadian composer Harry Summers is best known for his opera based on a Canadian historical theme. What is its title? It is Louis Riel. And who is the 20th century composer who introduced the system of atonal music based on a 12-tone scale?
Schoenberg.
It was Schoenberg. We have 5 minutes to go. The score is Oak Bay 280, Eric Hamber 175. Here's an open question for 30 points. September 1977 is the target date for conversion of all road signs to the metric system. Wait for the question. So it might be nice to know just how fast we'll be driving in the fall. Here's the question. Unless otherwise posted, 30 miles an hour is now the Terry.
55.
No, is now the maximum speed in a BC city. Hamber, how will this be expressed after the metric changeover? Answer, Simon.
45.
No, 50 kilometers per hour. Do these converted limits involve an increase or a decrease in actual speed limits? Ross.
An increase.
A slight increase is correct. And what agency is responsible for the development of uniform metric, Terry?
Metric Canada.
No, uniform metric highway markings across Canada, Eric Hamber. Simon?
Department of Highways?
It's the Council of Uniform Traffic Devices. Vocabulary builders next, so watch your monitors. I have eight words, 5 points for correct pronunciation, five more for acceptable definition. The first one is for Ross Chisholm, and here it is.
Parochial.
Okay.
Religious, as in parochial school.
No. Actually not. It's usually used in the sense of provincial or limited to a parish, Ross. Here's Roger Cluley's word now. What does Dane mean, Roger?
You allow it, but not really.
To what?
You allow it, but with a little bit of hesitation.
Okay, to condescend to give or accept. I'll take that. Eric, here's yours.
Modicum. The way something... Again, modicum. The way something is done, the orderly fashion.
No, I can't take either of those, actually. It's modicum, Eric, and it means a small amount or a tiny bit. Terry, here's yours.
Reticent.
Good.
Unwilling.
No.
Stubborn?
No, reticent means shy or withdrawn. Simon.
Panoply.
No, that's like monopoly. That's panoply in this instance. And what is a panoply?
It's a large flightless bird.
No, it isn't. It's a complete suit of armor, any complete or magnificent covering or array. For who is it, Pauline? This word?
Rudimentary.
And it is?
Basic starting point.
Elementary, sure. Michael.
Infinitesimal.
And what does infinitesimal mean?
Without limit.
No, it means too small to be measured. Have we one left for Alan? I hope so. There it is.
Multifaceted.
Yes, and it means?
It has many faces, many sides.
Good for you. Let's have a look at the score. Oak Bay has 315. Eric Hamber has 195. We have how much time? 2 minutes to go. Let's try the art very quickly, can we? We'll have three of these. For 10 points each, identify the masters who created these works of the 17th century. Here's the first one. And it is Eric?
Rubens.
Rubens is right. Here's the next. The next one, Eric?
Van Eyck.
No. Oak Bay, try it. Pauline?
Vermeer?
It is Vermeer. Here's the last. Coming up right there, Pauline?
Goya?
No. For Eric Hamber, it is Michael?
Rembrandt?
Velasquez. It's time for our short snappers, and we don't have too much time left. Let's see how you do with these. For art historians, which century is the Quattrocento? Eric?
The 14th.
No, it isn't. Pauline?
15th.
It is the 15th or 1400s. Who was the supreme commander of the Allied forces in Ross?
Dwight D. Eisenhower.
No, in World War I. Alan? Foch?
MacArthur.
At a Sadie Hawkins dance, what is unusual, Pauline?
Girls ask guys.
That's right. Who directed the movie Scenes from a Marriage? Eric?
M.R. Bergman.
What does the Latin in vino veritas mean? Terry?
In real truth?
No. Ross?
In wine truth.
That's right. Name the two countries that jointly own Tierra del Fuego. Eric?
Chile and Argentina.
You're right. Which famous waterfall is on the Rhodesian-Zambian border? Terry?
Victoria.
According to the Broadway song, what is there no business like? Terry?
Show business.
Put the following sentence into the passive voice. He cleans my clock. Terry Barnett?
My clock is cleaned by him.
That's right. According to Greek myth, how many ages of man are there? Pauline?
Seven.
No. Eric Hamber, how many ages? Ross?
Three.
There are five. How many moons revolve around the planet Uranus? Simon?
Four.
No. Okay. Roger?
Three.
There are five. What is the name for a female seal? She is called, Pauline?
A seal.
No. Simon?
A cow.
A cow is right. In what Western American state would you find Crater Lake? Answer, Eric.
Oregon.
It is Oregon. What was the name for the old intermission feature on Hockey Night in Canada where hockey...
Eric? Peter Puck.
No, where hockey experts discuss the game. Hot Stove League. There's the bell. End of the game. Oak Bay with 375. Eric Hamber, 255. We'll check the figures and return with our BC champion following these messages. It's official. Oak Bay, 375. Eric Hamber, 255. The winners and our new BC champions, Oak Bay. Here they are once again. Roger Cluley, Terry Barnett, Pauline Bunn, and Alan Horgan. Let's hear it for a terrific runner-up team from Eric Hamber, Ross Chisholm, Eric Promislow, Simon Van Norden, and Michael Potter. As you know, the scholarship awards on Reach for the Top are provided by our sponsors, the Fraser Valley Milk Producers Association and Nissan Automobile Canada Limited. Right now, I'm going to ask the captain of the runner-up Eric Hamber team, Ross Chisholm, to come down to center stage, where, presenting a $500 scholarship check to Eric Hamber Secondary School, we have Mr. Mickey Mickey, the president of Nissan Automobile Company of Canada Limited. Now, the captain of the Oak Bay team, the only lady on both teams, Pauline Bunn, is coming down to center stage. Here with a $1,500 scholarship check for our new BC champions, Mr. Neil Gray, the general manager, Fraser Valley Milk Producers Association. And now presenting the CBC trophy to our new provincial champions, director of the province, CBC, Mr. Len Locke. Our new BC champions will now go on to take part in the Reach for the Top National Playoff this summer. And I know you'll join me in wishing them continued success. And so ends season number 16. Now I'd like to close with a note of appreciation to our sponsors. These are the people who pay for the show, who give out the scholarship money, and who provide constant encouragement. In short, they make it all possible. I'm happy to say we'll be back next fall, Fridays at 7:30, and I hope we'll see you then on Reach for the Top.